Mirëmëngjesit gjithëve. Mirë se keni ardhur në këtë konferencë rajonale. Aktiviteti fillon me këtë panel plenar hapës, I cili është ndarë në tre bloke. Blokun e parë janë fjalët përshëndetëse nga organizatorët dhe ftuar nderit. Blokun e dytë janë një panel prej 9 përfaqësues të lartë të qeverive të vendeve të Ballkanit Perëndimor dhe inkluzivisht vendeve të tjera të rajonit, së bashku me aktorë të rëndësishëm të shoqërisë civile, ku do të moderohet nga Linda Oster. Dhe bloku I tretë I aktivitetit është që ne kemi gjithë Bright Spot Presentation, ku 5-6 vende, Ballkani Perëndimor, do të pasqyrojë një praktikë mirë të këtyre vendeve, cilat do nështrohet edhe një votimi të gjithpranishme për dhënë çmimin fitues nesër, si praktikë më të mirë rajonale, për sa I përket mirëqeverisjes dhe qeverisjes së hapur, që është dhe të vitje I këti forumi dhe aktivitetit. E ndërruar zonja nënkryetare e kuvendit, Valentina Leske, ndërruar zonja ministre e HARITO, bashkë organizatore tashmë dhe bashkëpunëtore tashmë prej 2 vitesh, në kuadrin e nismës së partneritetit për qeverisje të hapur, ndërruar ministra, deputet, ndërruar kolegë qeverisje civile, shkretësi ambasador, ndërruar dashur miq, nuk është e shpesh mundësia për të komunikuar me një auditor të tillë, të larmishëm, me përfaqësues të lartë institucioneve shtetërore, shoqërisë civile, biznesit, medias, nga gjithë rajoni edhe Europa më gjerë. Për këtë arsye jam shumë I lumtur që më jepet rasti të hap të konferencë dhe t'ju uroj një mesazh të ngrohtë dhe të diskutimeve të fridhëndëse. Falënismës dhe angazhimit tonë në kuadër partneritetit për qeverisje të hapur, është bërë mund realizimi këtij forumi të parë ballkanik dy ditor në Tiranë. Është kjo një mundësi për të shkëmbyer një kohësisht përfituar nga përvojat më të mira të vendeve pjesëmarrëse në rajonin dhe më gjerë. Besoj se ndajmë të gjithë me gjithë pjesëmarrës shqyrimin për të bërë më të mirë në mundshme, për të dhënë një shtys të re reformave që lidhen me qeverisjen e hapur, për të krijuar një raport sa më sinergjik midis qeverisë, aktorëve publik, social dhe shoqërisë civile. Është vështirë në angazhimin deri tanishëm ndaj partneritetit për qeverisje të hapur dhe shpresoj se ky aktivitet do të shërbejë si një moment tjetër I rëndësishëm për vendet e Ballkanit Perëndimor për të ndarë përvojat duke rivlerësuar pozicionin dhe bashkëpunimin e aktorëve në plan kombëtar e rikonsideruar objektivat në vazhdimsi. Partneriteti për qeverisje të hapur nuk përbën thjesht një tjetër nismë në radhën e nismave ndërkombëtare globale, ku vendet si ato tonat duhet të bëjnë detyrat e shtëpisë, qoftë si qeveri, qoftë si shoqëri civile. Nuk është thjesht një tjetër projekt që nis dhe mbaron. OGP-ja nuk do fonde ekstra për të qenë suksesshëm. Sekondor nuk duhet të mbetet pronë e qeverisë apo elitave të shoqërisë. Partneriteti për qeverisje të hapur mund të shihet në tërësinë e vet si një platformë për të përgjigjur sfidave të përditshme të mirëqeverisjes me të cilat përballen shoqërit tona. Partneriteti për qeverisje të hapur me parimet, objektivat, drejtimet, për hapjet të qeverisjes, për mirësimin e shërbimeve publike, për gjejshmërin, llogaridhënien, luftën kundër korrupsionit, për shirjen e qytetarëve dhe të shoqërisë, për mirësimin e politikave publike bazuar në evidenca, janë përbëjnë përgjigje ndaj sfidave të sotme të vendeve tona në gjitha drejtimet. Nderuar pjesëmarrës, aktiviteti dytor është konceptuar nga organizatat partnere nga gjithë rajoni për të shërbyer ngritjes mbi përvojat dhe rivlerësimin e arritjeve deri tanishme për të riprojektuar qasjen si në plan kombëtar ashtu edhe atë rajonal. Shpresoj që angazhimet rajonale për qeverisje të hapur, që do të botuara edhe në këtë broshur të aktivitetit të vendeve të Ballkanit Perëndimor, nëse rezultojnë të suksesshme, do jetë një arritje shumë e madhe, e cila mund ndaje në samitin e global të partneriteti për qeverisje të hapur që do mbaje në muajin e ardhshëm në Meksik. Sot, ne kemi ardhur këtu në këtë aktivitet falë mbështetjes së Bashkimit Evropian. dhe partnerëve të IDM-s si ambasada e Shtetit të Bashkuar të Amerikës, UNDP dhe Fondi Ballkanik për Demokraci BTD. Po kështu ne patëm mbështetjen e Taksos, NDI-t, OSIT dhe ambasadës britanike. Ndihmës të vyer patëm nga komiteti drejtues dhe njësia mbështetëse e OGP-s. Paul Mason nga jashtë dhe Erisa Lame nga brenda kanë rolin e tyre. Së bashku zgjodhëm të brendojmë këtë forum si dialogu balkanik, sepse gjithçka këtu është iniciuar dhe zhvilluar nga ne. Domethënë nga përfaqësuesit e qeverive dhe organizatave partnere të vendeve të rajonit. Dërsa si IDM, ne kemi bërë gjithçka të mundur që çdo vend partner i Ballkanit Perëndimor ta ndjejë veten bashku organizator dhe bashku realizues i këtij forumi. Për ta mbyllur, do t'i kthesha edhe një herë përmbajtjes së aktivitetit, duke lënë fortore, sepse tim nuk figuron më në agjendë, dy ditët, me pyetje. A do të arrijmë të realizojmë gjatë këtij forumi një diskutim të hapur për të arritur në një qartësi dhe dakordësi për indikator performance të matshëm në kuadër të angazhimeve rajonale për qeverisje të hapur? Ne duhet të lëmë të forum me një platformë sa më qartë reformuese që në aktivitetin e ardhshëm të dialogut balkanik të dim të vendosim qartë si pikat mbi. Faleminderit, zonja ministre.
Faleminderit zoti Roni, më thjesht më njoftojnë që ka një problem me përkthimin, kështu që do më duhet të pres shumë pak, shpresoj derisa të zgjidhet. Në mënyrë që miqtë tan që janë It's okay? Okay, perfect. It was a problem with the connection. Okay. So I can begin. Atëherë të faleminderit edhe një herë zoti Roni dhe IDM që janë bashkë organizues të këtij eventi. Të nderuar pjesëmarrës nga rajoni, homolog, zonja nën kryetare e parlamentit që na nderon me praninë e saj, përfaqësues të institucioneve të pavarura dhe gjithashtu kolegë ministra dhe deputet. Ju falenderoj zotrinj ambasador sigurisht dhe mbështetës të kësaj iniciative. Ju falenderoj shumë. Sigurisht në emrin tim, por edhe në emrin e kryeministrit të Shqipërisë, zotit Edi Rama, i cili për shkak të një agjende të papritur kishte parashikuar të ishte këtu dhe nuk mundi të ishte këtu me ne sot. Kjo është një nismë që merret për herë të parë në rajon dhe për këtë do doja të theksoja edhe një herë që dinamizmi ballkanik i cili mund të marrë lloj-lloj formash, në të vërtet mund të shfaqet edhe në format e veta më të mira, kur përqafon një iniciativë si iniciativa për partneritetin për qeverisjen e hapur. Kjo është një nismë në të vërtet që ka filluar në vitin 2011 nga presidenti Obama dhe ka patur në fillimet e saj vetëm 8 vende nismëtare, ndërsa sot janë 65 të tilla. Shqipëria, që në kryet të herës ka qënë pjesare e kësaj nisme, e cila në thelbin e saj synon që në përmjet reformave të rrisi nivelin e transparencës, të përgjegjësisë dhe të aktivizimit qytetar. Por, unë jam njëri konkret dhe dua ta bëj gjën pak më konkrete. Dhe për këtë do të jap dy shembuj. E para, bota digitale e bën transparencën në të vërtet një domosdoshmëri që nuk ke si i shpëton. Dhe për t'ju dhënë vetëm një shifër, në 24 orë në botën digitale qarkullojnë 45 miliard e-maile. Tani, të gjithë e kuptojmë që me transferime, ritransferime dhe ripërsëritje, transparenca është aty duam apo zduam ne, nga një ranë. Nga ana tjetër, ana pozitive e kësaj gjëje, është zhvillimi ekonomik që kjo sjell. transparenca. Dhe për ta shpjeguar këtë, do t'ju jap një shembull që disa ndoshta e din, por të tjerë mund mos e din, që është shembulli i GPS-it. Sot të gjithë ne që kur ngasim një makinë, na duket normale që të mos dimë rrugët se ku shkojmë sepse kemi GPS. Por nuk e dinë se gjithë e dinë, të gjithë ata që ngasin një makinë, që kjo vjen për shkak të dhënave të hapura. Të dhënat që përdor GPS-i ishin të dhëna të cilat i përdorte vetëm le të themi ushtria amerikane dhe ishin të dhëna të mbyllura deri në një farë momenti, deri kur u mori iniciativa për të thënë që këto të dhëna që dukeshin ndoshta aq të rëndësishme që të mbaheshin të mbyllura, mund të hapeshin dhe të vijeshin në dispozicion publikut. Çfarë bëri kjo? Kjo solli zhvillim ekonomik në radhë parë, solli inovacion dhe solli zhvillim ekonomik. Pra të dhënat e hapura janë diçka shumë konkrete që mund të na sjellin ndryshim, zhvillim ekonomik, zhvillim social. Le të vim te kjo konferencë që ka do thoja disa karakteristika. Karakteristika e saj e parë dhe më e rëndësishme është ajo që unë pak e përmenda, është zhvillimi rajonal dhe fakti që zhvillohet në rajonin tonë, që është një nga rajonet ndoshta që ka njohur më ashpër se çdo zonë tjetër, përballjen me antipodet e vlerave të OGP-s, me izolimin, me arbitraritetin, me mungesën e transparencës. Dhe pikrisht kjo histori e jona e përbashkët ka krijuar një traditë e cila e do meritokracinë dhe transparencën, por e do deri tek kufiri i shtëpisë së cilit. Pra se cili e do transparencën për të tjerët, por jo për vete. Dhe pikrisht fakti që ne jemi mbledhur këtu sot tregon që kjo gjë është duke ndryshuar, sigurisht jo aq shpejt sa do të donim, sigurisht gjithmonë më shumë gjëra janë për të bërë, por fakti që ne jemi gjithë bashkë këtu në rajon është për mua një lajm shumë i mirë. Elementi tjetër i dytë shumë i rëndësishëm është përqafimi i OGP-s gjithmonë më shumë nga qeveritë. Në fillim, shoqëria civile ka qenë ajo që nxiste gjithnjëherë më shumë vlerat e OGP-s. Sot gjithmonë më shumë qeveritë bëhen promotore dhe iniciatore të vlerave të OGP-s dhe të transparencës. Dhe këtu do më lejoni këta zgjatur shumë të jap disa shembuj për cilët do të kemi rast të flasim gjatë këtyre dy ditëve, po disa shembuj shumë të mirë, shumë të spikatur të qeverisë tonë, që janë një prej tyre është portali antikorrupsion, për cilin do të keni rastin të dëgjoni pastaj më shumë detaje, por që ka funksionuar shumë mirë, një portal ku jepet mundësia që të denoncohen shumë e shumë raste korrupsioni. Një tjetër element shumë i rëndësishëm është ai që ne e quajmë komisariati digital, që nëse nuk e keni në telefonat tuaj ju ftoj ta ngarkoni dhe ta përdorni sepse është gjithashtu një aplikacion shumë i këndshëm dhe shumë i thjeshtë për të përdorur. Dhe një tjetër rast që unë e kam shumë për zemër, megjithëse sigurisht gjithmonë mund përmirësohet, është portali unik i administratës publike, i cili ka bërë në të vërtetë, pse e kam shumë për zemër, sepse ka sjellë një ndryshim mentaliteti. Nuk është çështja vetëm te teknologjia, çështja është që duke krijuar një portë unike të vetme për të gjithë ata që dëshirojnë të hyjnë në administratën publike, në shërbimin civil më saktë, jo në administratën publike, e cila është më e gjerë se aq, vetvetiu kemi krijuar të gjitha mundësitë që njerëzit të informohen, të jenë të barabartë në trajtimin e tyre, të kenë mundësi të njëjta për t'u ankuar. Dhe prova më e mirë për këtë është që 20.000 vetëm gjatë vitit fundit kanë përdorur këtë portal unik, i cili sigurisht si të gjithë elementet e teknologjisë ka nevojë për përmirësimet e veta në mënyrë që të bëhet gjithmonë më miqësor, por çështja nuk është kjo, çështja është që kjo gjë të përdoret sa më shumë. Pra, angazhimi i qeverive dhe i qeverisë tonë veçanërisht është jashtëzakonisht i rëndësishëm për OGP-n dhe sigurisht ajo që mbetet gjithmonë është bashkëpunimi sa më i thellë, sa më i fortë me shoqërinë civile dhe këtu është shumë e rëndësishme. Dhe unë e kam për zemër gjithashtu të bëj thirrje që shoqëria civile të na ndihmojë të progresojmë, sepse ky është roli i saj. Të na kontrollojë, të na kritikojë, të na thotë se si mund të përmirësohemi, sepse për këtë është shoqëria civile dhe për këtë bashkëpunimi jonë me shoqërinë civile është i domosdoshëm. Dhe sigurisht në planin ton kombëtar, në fakt angazhimeve që kemi marrë në OGP, një pjesë shumë e madhe e iniciativave dhe e çfarë kemi ndërmarrë aty janë angazhime të përbashkëta të qeverisë dhe të shoqërisë civile. Sigurisht, rëndësia e një konferencë rajonale bëhet edhe më e spikatur në vazhdon e procesit të Berlinit, me konferencën e Berlinit të vendeve të rajonit për para një viti dhe me konferencën e Vienës për para një muaj, pra është një nga elementet e bashkëpunimit rajonal që është shumë i rëndësishëm, që mund bëjë një ndryshim real për rajonin tonë, dhe shpresoj që këto dy ditë të shërbejnë pra për të nxitur të gjithë partneritetin në Ballkanin Perëndimor në kuadër të kësaj nisme. Nuk më mbetet gjë tjetër veç se t'ju falenderoj dhe të ftoj pasardhësit për të folur zotin Ronit.
Më lejoni të bëjë ditë pranime edhe të zotit Nicola Bertolini, profesues nga Bashkimi Evropian, i cili në emër të delegacionit Bashkimit Evropian do përshëndesim dhe më pasti të ftoj zëvendës ambasador të Evropës së Ardhur në Shqipëri për zotit David Muniz, zëvendës ambasador i Shtetit Bashkuar të Amerikës, dhe të lutem marr fjalën përshëndesi më një herë pas fjalës zotit Bertolini. Faleminderit.
Dear Minister HARITO, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, we are dealing with people, people in the government, people in the civil society, people in the streets, people who are going to work, people who do not have work, but people who care about the public. What is public? The open government partnership is a part of a comprehensive effort to encourage governments to become more transparent. The commitments taken by your governments in the framework of this project and beyond are important and encouraging. An empowered civil society is a crucial component of any democratic system. Democracy is a collaborative effort between the state and the citizens. When citizens hold their governments accountable, this motivates politicians to make better decisions. Considering views and expertise from different parts of a society make decisions more informed. This process can only be realized if government is open and transparent, allowing citizens to make informed and critical contributions, and if politicians consider the views of the people they represent. For these reasons, the European Union sets standards of transparent and accountable governance that prospective member states must meet in order to move forward in the integration process. We work with governments of the Western Balkans to ensure that proper mechanisms are in place to ensure accountability and transparency, and that the rules underpinning the policy-making process are followed. Reform of the public administration, along with strengthening the rule of law and economic governance, are fundamental aspects of EU integration. Civil society has important contributions to make in all of these respects. The OGP aims to open governments to citizens, to achieve the benefits of participatory democracy. More informed and accountable policy making. This is all about. The process provides the opportunity for governments and civil society to elaborate and implement national action plans to achieve these goals. The outcomes we would like to see are concrete commitments from governments to promote transparency and accountability, empower citizens, fight corruption, and make use of new technologies to strengthen governance and provide better service to the citizens. Part of the project's purpose is to provide a platform for people engaged in reform to share ideas and experiences. Positive examples we can notice in Montenegro and Serbia, where civil society is engaged in the integration process, in the EU negotiations. We are glad to see that all Western Balkan countries have made commitments to take part in the open governance partnership process. While some progress has been made, more efforts are needed to improve partnership and dialogue between governments and civil society organizations. In all countries, public consultation on draft laws and policies are provided by the law, but not always implemented. From our regional project Advocacy for Open Government, the European Union is supporting the OGP initiative in the Western Balkan region to help your countries to get closer to our standards. The EU also provides extensive support to the Western Balkans towards creating an enabling legal and financial environment for civil society organizations, improving civil society organizations' government relations, and enhancing the capacity and sustainability of civil society organizations. An important signal in this regard, specifically related to Albania, is that the funds planned for the empowering of civil society during the next 2 years is going to be more than double as compared to the previous period. In total, we are planning to invest more than 3% of all the accession-related financial resources, called IPA, to civil society development in all this country. Here in Albania, civil society organizations have in recent years become more active in policy making. And maybe we also helped this. And especially in legislation, the government, on the other side, has also showed that they are interested in improving their cooperation with civil society. This year, Albania set up the National Council for European Integration and has also taken preliminary steps to set up the National Council for Civil Society, what we were asking them to do since a long time. We are very close. The approval is expected to be this month in the Albanian Parliament. These two councils are crucial fora for including civil society in the integration process and in the overall policy reform process of the country. But we should not stop there. It's not the establishment of a council that gives a big result. This is just a benchmark in the way we have to work. In fact, there are many remaining challenges to inclusive and open governance in Albania. The Open Government Partnership is one more opportunity for you to address these challenges. I can mention three of them. Access to information for citizens and the media should be improved, and decision making should be more transparent, first. Second, consultations with civil society organizations and the broader public should become more systematic. Very good, the Albanian Parliament approval of the importance to open dialogue with civil society. Now we have to see the implementation. To this end, we will encourage and monitor the enforcement of a new law on consultation. Third, local authorities still need to develop an inclusive dialogue with civil society and local communities. Open governance address fundamental democratic needs. Participatory democracy leads to more informed and better decision making. It is all about giving every citizen the opportunity to make a meaningful contribution. Thank you and good luck.
Jess, good morning. Minister HARITO, Mr. Bertolini, Mr. HRONI, Mr. Masson, Madam Deputy Speaker, dear guests. In September 2011, President Obama joined the leaders of seven of the nations in announcing the launch of the Open Government Partnership, a global effort to encourage transparent, effective, and accountable governance. Today, the OGP has grown to 65 countries. All of the Western Balkan countries have joined or have committed to join OGP. Member countries have made commitments to improving the governance of more than 2 billion people around the globe by embracing the key principles of open government, promoting transparency, fighting corruption, and energizing civic engagement through new technologies and approaches to strengthen the democratic functions of our countries. The partnership is now a global community of government reformers, civil society leaders, and business innovators working together to advance good governance and implement ambitious open government reforms. Your presence here today at the Balkans OGP Dialogue highlights both the importance of this partnership and recognizes this region's progress towards eventual membership in Euro-Atlantic structures. The U.S. Embassy is proud to support this process. Why do we think the OGP is critical? We know that countries with open governments will become more secure, peaceful, and prosperous. This is why we were one of the founding members of the partnership and have taken steps to make our own government more transparent, effective, and accountable as a result. We hope that through dialogues such as this one, you will collaborate to create initiatives that further open government in countries throughout the region. Before coming to Albania recently, I've also had the pleasure of serving in Montenegro and in Kosovo. I know very well the challenges this region faces. I can say personally that I've been proud to contribute what I am able as an American diplomat to help the region move forward. For all the differences between the countries of the Western Balkans, there are even more similarities. Regional cooperation, especially through OGP, is essential for progress toward a stronger and more successful Balkan region. I commend the government and the people of Albania for their support of such initiatives, and commit to you that the United States will continue to back efforts that strengthen regional relationships. We are pleased that Albania and the other countries of the region were among the very first countries to join the OGP. We praise the efforts of the Albanian government to consult and engage civil society during the process of drafting and implementing the Second Action Plan for 2014 and 2015. But of course, as my colleague has said, the key is in the implementation. This is critical because civil society organizations not only help hold governments accountable, but are also invaluable partners in leveraging technology and in identifying new approaches to making the government work for all citizens. I have seen much civil society engagement in this region. I know how effective it can be. Nonetheless, while progress has been made, the fundamental challenges to the region remain. Among the toughest challenges is the fight against corruption. Along these lines, I'm happy to see that many organizations which focus on anti-corruption from across the region are here today, such as the Montenegrin anti-corruption NGO MONTS, the Balkan Investigative Research Network, and other organizations I have been proud to work with in the past. One very effective way to combat corruption in the government is through transparency in government spending. In the United States, we've seen how websites such as data.gov make federal, state, and local data on everything from agriculture to education to public safety available to citizens. When citizens can see how their government spends taxpayer money, they can hold it accountable. Albania has also taken concrete action to fight corruption. One example, the online portal www.stopcorruptionit.al. Citizens are encouraged to denounce corruption and help fight it. Another challenge I would highlight is judicial reform, ensuring that the justice system is accessible and fair to all citizens. A successful judicial reform process is an absolutely critical step in Albania's path toward developing a more open government and society. We hope to see significant progress in this area in the months to come. Combating corruption and reforming the justice system are not only in line with OGP values, but they are vital to the EU integration process. Now, as an American, I can say that the best way for Albania to have the strongest possible relationship and partnership with the United States, and the best way for Albania to serve its own people, is through a successful effort to meet European standards and join the European Union. And this is why the United States cares so much about the EU integration process in this country, why we spend so much time and money and effort to support it, and why we work so closely with Albania, Albanian government, and our European friends and allies to contribute what we can to make EU integration a reality here. Today, I congratulate all of you for your commitment to the principles of open government, access to information, civic participation, accountability, and utilizing technology and innovation to achieve all of these things. Before I close, I would like to share the words of President Obama on the founding of this partnership. He said, "We pledge to be more transparent at every level, because more information on government activity should be open, timely, and freely available to people. We need to pledge to engage more of our citizens in decision-making, because it makes government more effective and more responsive. We pledge to implement the highest standards of integrity, because those in power must serve the people, not themselves. And we pledge to increase access to technology, because in this digital century, access to information is a right that is universal. This event is a great opportunity for all of us to reaffirm the commitment to open government. This includes those of us in government, but also those of you in civil society, private sector, and everyone gathered here today. I wish all of you success in this very important endeavor and in this conference. Father Nadarchun."
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome you for the first opening panel of this event. My name is Linda Oster. I am the member of the board of Policy Association for Open Society, an organization that is proud to have as one of our members the IDM, the esteemed organizers of the event today. So with no further delays, I will invite to the stage your esteemed panelists and our esteemed panelists, a really excellent panel we will host today. So Minister Milena Harito, Excellency, please join us on the stage. I will show you the central place to join. Minister Vukic Lozovic, the Minister for Information Society and Communications in Montenegro, please. Please come and join the Minister on the other side. For the host, please join on the right side. The Serbian representative, Mr. Jeliko Ozegovic, State Secretary from the Ministry for Public Administration and Local Self-Government. Mr. Ozegovic. Ms. Teuta Arifi, Mayor of Tetovo Municipality here from Albania, please join us on the stage. Ms. Dragana Anđelić, Ministry for Foreign Affairs of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Ms. Anđelić, please. Ms. Kuitim Gashi, I do apologize for the pronunciation, not my Albanian, definitely not in the best shape. Mr. Gashi is representing the Ministry for Public Administration of Kosovo. Igor Vibacak, Government for Croatia, Kosovo Government Contact Point of OGP, Mr. Vibacak. Paul Masin, representing the OGP as such, and as I sometimes do say, he's the evangelist of OGP. Paul, please join us on the stage. And finally, last but not least, Mr. Radu Puiciu, representing the Government of Romania, he's the State Secretary and also closely involved with the OGP processes in Romania, please. So as we start the discussion today, I will sit on the side. We have an hour and 9 excellent speakers, so not willing to take any minute from your valuable contributions. If I may open the discussion today with a very broad question, that a bit more than a year ago, I was in Tirana chairing another discussion. Then most of the representatives, if not all, I should say all, the representatives of the private sector, the government, civil society organizations, there was nobody from the government. So there must have been some fundamental switch during this year that invited all of you on the stage and ready to give your contributions. So if I may ask, what was the fundamental switch during this year that brought you to this stage ready to share? Has OGP matured? Do we have a different, better OGP? How does it help your country and your political goals to be implemented? So please, you have the microphone.
Point my
side to
Mr. Harito.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll speak. Yes, it is a broad question, but I think the key words here are inclusion and trustworthiness. For us, the OGP is almost all, I think, as other colleagues from the region can say that also, is also a question of having more trust in what the governments are doing. So to have more inclusion, the inclusion of the civil society and their engagement is very important for our actions. We can undertake actions, but if they are not trusted by our citizens and endorsed by the civil society, it's no worth on it. So I think we have done a big work to include largely the civil society in the elaboration of our national action plan, and this is the reason why we are together here today.
Thank you, Minister. So if we pass it on to Minister Lazovic, how about your country? What was the fundamental switch that brings you here?
Esteemed colleagues, coordinators and members of OGP worker groups, respective NGO representatives, private sector representatives, representatives of the media, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to extend warmest greetings on behalf of Government of Montenegro and Ministry of Information Society and Telecommunication. Thank you for this invitation and the occasion to underline the activities of Montenegro in strengthening its engagement under the Open Government Partnership. Like other Western Balkans countries, Montenegro has functioned for almost half a century as a complex and inter-administrative structure. The transition process and the transformation towards a modern society has brought about new trends, and with them an increasing number of public requests for providing better quality and services. Open public administration means to us in Montenegro to reform of the government itself in order to be able to meet the expectation of its citizens. The government of Montenegro has a clear vision that it's necessary to provide adequate capacities for creating a transparent, accountable and efficient public government. Such public government cannot be created overnight, why the Open Government Partnership is a common initiative for a broad dialogue in order to reach the desired outcomes. In this regard, our government defined the activities which clearly convey our commitment to economic stability and better living standard. Now I will get the answer for your direct question. Referencing out some of the activities of the government of Montenegro. First is further improvement of the legal framework, fiscal transparency. Second, upgrade of the e-government portal. Third, promotion of electronic services and e-government portal. Parliament of Montenegro last year adopted a special law of e-government. It's very important not only for GP, it's very important for the development of information society in Montenegro. And finally, further implementation of policies in the field of public administration reform and open data concepts. The government of Montenegro set us one of its priorities, the fight against corruption on all its levels, and I am confident that with every passing day we will achieve better results on this important field. Our goal is to create and maintain public confidence in a responsible and accountable performance of the tasks of public administrations. We will remain committed in the coming period to meeting the standards and values of modern societies by creating the necessary normative and institutional preconditions. In this context, the exchange of view and experience between countries whose representatives are present today and this meeting will significantly contribute to the fulfillment of our common goals. It is creation of public government which is able to sustain the achievements of stable democratic institutions, the rule of law and the respect of human rights to establish principles of good public administration. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. If I may pass on to the State Secretary of Ministry of Public Administration, Local Government of Serbia. However, a slight note, we are limited in time, so let's be limited in comments. Be proud, be courageous, and let's give a lot of food for thought for the discussions in the two upcoming days. Please.
Pleasure to participate in this conference and OGP for the government of Serbia is understood as an excellent way and tool, I have to say, to implement the general objectives of public administrative reform in our country. We are strongly in that process, and the aim of that process is to provision of high quality services of citizens and business, and creation of public administration which will significantly contribute to stability and raising living standards. This title, open government, engage citizens, I'm sure, with citizens who participate in decisions, is the vision I'm sure that we share and we want to achieve, but how we come to that? It is very important, I think, for our country and for this region, because of that better understanding of our countries, better political stability and security, as somebody says in the introduction, economic growth and better standard of living. And, we strongly believe that inclusion of civil society in decision-making process is the key element of the open government concept, this concept. And, that is why we have been drafting the action plan together with the representative of civil society organization in Serbia, and we are proud to say that our action plan for the period 2015 and 2016 is a result of joint efforts of both government authorities and civil society. But let me be more specific. In my opinion, new draft law of administrative procedure is new law of inspection oversight, which I present later in the next session, is a good example how to Republic of Serbia is trying to evolve the NGO sector to raise the level of responsibility, predictability and transparency of the public administration. That draft law passed the public hearing procedure, and the NGO were called to participate not only in that procedure but also in drafting the solutions in that law. And that law has many good new solutions for improve services of public administrations for the citizens, including new system of violation charges for not maintaining official records, which is very important when we speak about the open data, which needs anyway to be publicly available, and the introduction, and I think that is the one good example. The second good example is the law of inspection oversights. In that process, Transparency International were included from the beginning at the end, and now is implementation, and I'll talk about it later, and many NGOs included in that implementation.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ozegovic. We have another wonderful panelist, something that I have in my experience of panels related to OGP never seen or heard before. Ms. Teuta Arifi is the mayor of Tetovo municipality in Macedonia. I believe that the municipal vision and reflections on OGP is even more important sometimes than it is from the central governments, since where else is the government closer to you as in your local government? So, madame, your vision is truly important.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me here. Municipality of Tetovo is normally a second municipality in Macedonia. It's a multi-ethnic municipality. The majority of population living there is ethnic Albanian origin, and at the same time is a seat of two universities. To speak for the challenges, which are very much political and philosophical, put it in this table, I would like just to speak from the difference of the governments, because I've spent 9 years as member of Macedonian Parliament, 2 years as Vice Prime Minister for European Integration and normally going for elections for the city of Tetova was as well a very serious challenge. Which one is different among the position of the minister and the position of the mayor? It was a friend of mine who made me this very clear. He said to me that when you are a minister, in your door you get a letter. Letters. When you are a mayor, in your door you get the people. It's a question how you do the management between both of them, because every time it is a little bit more easier to manage the letters that you receive, but not every time very easy to manage the people that you get in your door for the different requirements that they have. So that the concept and the idea of being open and transparent is a question of a decision of the policy makers that they really want to do the work in that way. Is that easy? No, it's not. Because as a nature, the human nature is a nature who would like to keep some things untold, some things uninformed, some things just for us, and something not every time everybody to know. So that in the moment when we are ready to go for open politics, definitely we have to be ready for the fact that yes, we want to face all the things that sometimes we don't like, all the things that sometimes we don't agree, and in the mentality of our new democracies, which are in the process of building, is not every time a very easy thing. So that our countries normally they are ongoing in a different internal processes of inter-democracy development, and I think that Macedonia is one of those examples. So that the process of internal democratization, it is a question of the decision, it is the question that really the policy makers, they have to make their own decisions. So that I would like just to give one small example how I have decided to do some innovative experiences in our municipality. For example, we set up the process, the very official and very well organized process of the meeting of the citizens. The meeting of the citizens, of the people, which they apply each Monday for a date for the mayor, and all of them they get a date to see the mayor and to discuss. Actually, until now I have met more than 12,000 people directly. My aim is until the end of my mandate to have a meeting with 24,000 people. This was the number of the voters they have voted me. From our analysis that we do, actually the 80% of people who are coming to see the mayor, they are requiring a job, a place to work, which is once again speaking and explaining the phenomenon of our democracies, where in our highly, very high politicized societies, definitely the politics, it is a direction when you ask the way out for all the problems, including the employment and other things. It is something that we all, in this level of all Balkanian meetings, we have to think how our politics definitely not to be just a way out and the way how the people to mobilize and to make a political clientelism. I think that the political clientelism in general, it is somehow, it is my strong opinion, is eating our societies from the new ideas of the young people who can be included, but they don't have obligatory to be part of one or another political party. This is the reason why I am very grateful for the possibility and the invitation of being here, being part of this panel, not making the story too long, but just to say that the democracy, it is a daring concept. So that in the moment when we enter to do some steps, then definitely first of all we have to dare that really the changes can be done. When I became a candidate for the municipality of Tetovo, there have been a people who have been saying that they don't need even to make a campaign to win me because nobody will vote for a woman. But you never know what the people, the citizens trust very much, so that the values of being sincere, being open, and being anti-corruptive, I think that it is a value that I like very much to promote. So that sometimes when somebody says that maybe we didn't make so much of changes in our municipality except of the fact that we don't misuse the budget, I ask everybody to try to do the same, and maybe then we will see the difference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Arbeti. Your last sentence reminded me of something that I heard a long time ago. It was a question, so how do we solve all the problems that we have in that case in Latvia? And the answer was very simple, with more integrity for everybody, not just governments, but for every single person. And I think it would solve a lot of problems we see today in discussions put on the agenda of the upcoming days. But as we follow on with our introductory remarks and sparkling ideas to be followed up in the upcoming days, may I give the floor to Ms. Dragana Angelic, representing Ministry for Foreign Affairs, Bosnia and Herzegovina, and to give remarks from the Bosnia and Herzegovina side.
I just would like to say that first of all, Bosnia and Herzegovina became the 65th member of the multilateral Asian Global Government Partnership, and we are now in stage of development of its first national action plan. Goals and principles of the OGP are in compliance with objectives and authorities of Bosnia and Herzegovina, and with regard to transparency and openness. They are harmonized with the principles that Bosnia and Herzegovina would like to achieve its aspiration in relation to join the European Union, as well as goals for economic and social. OGP has absolute support of the government of Bosnia and Herzegovina, from the Council of Ministers to the Presidency of Bosnia and Herzegovina. The potential value in opening up public data in terms of social and economic development, but also improvements to transparency and the functioning of public institutions of Bosnia and Herzegovina are good enough reasons for more serious efforts in that direction. Much of the data can and should be made available as soon as possible while respecting existing laws which regulate exceptions to disclosure. The benefit of this event for Bosnia and Herzegovina from this event is enormous. Bosnia and Herzegovina was expected to submit its action plan by the end of June 2015 according to OGP calendar due to difficulties that arose. Unfortunately, this deadline was missed. Right now, our government is in the process of establishing the National OGP Council, and the goal is to make an action plan that will match the realistic capacity of public institutions, the need of citizens, and interests of relevant stakeholders. I would like to underline that civil society sector and the positive role is leading the process of preparing the development of our national action plan through their initiative until the process of forming a coordinating body that will develop and implement the NAP is unblocked. As far as Bosnia and Herzegovina, we can say that Bosnia speaks open government to some extent. There are many positive examples that may be shared at this event, but Bosnia and Herzegovina faces challenges with respect to openness of government as such as the other countries in the region. We adopted a law on free access to information first in the region in 2000, which provides a good basis for promoting the principles of openness. All the institutions at the level of the Council of Ministers have to act in accordance with the law on free access to information and to provide the necessary information at the request of citizens. Of course, the law on free access to information is not ideal. Raising the level of standardization and proactive transparency is something to which we aspire. Well, on the end, I would like to underline only that the next step for Bosnia is to make the action plan, which will precisely define issues that have to be worked on in order to achieve the set of principles and the improvement in the areas defined as problematic. The issues will be defined by the representatives of the government and civil society. The focus of the whole idea of the OGP initiative is the cooperation and to the system. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Andrzej. I may pass on. Time is ticking and the questions are raising, and there's perhaps at least one question to answer at the end. If I may pass on to Mr. Kuntin Gashi, who is representing the Ministry of Public Administration in Kosovo. Mr. Gashi will speak in Albanian, so those of you who understand it, you are very lucky people. Those of you who don't, please use your headphones. This is why we got the headphones for all the other participants here. Thank you.
E ndërruara Ministre HARITO, e ndërruara përfaqësues, në të cilën të trajtohen çështet që janë të rëndësishme për rrjedhat demokratike në rajonin tonë. Gjithashtu, me qenë se Kosova nuk është antare e iniciativës Open Government Partnership, më në që fillimisht të prezentoj aktivitetet e ndërmarra për antarësimin e Kosovës në Open Government Partnership. Qeveria e Kosovës në nën korrikt të vitit 2013 ka marrë vendim për fillimin e procedurave të antarësimit Kosovës në OGP. Në bazë të këtij vendimi, Republika e Kosovës ka autorizuar Ministrinë e Integrimeve Evropiane që të krijojë grupin bashkëpunës nga Ministria e Integrimeve Evropiane dhe Lëvizja Fol nga Shoqëria Civile për koordinimin e antarësimit Kosovës në grupin koordinues. Sipas këtij vendimi, përfaqësuesi i shoqërisë civile, përfaqësues sektorit biznesit, institucioneve publike dhe grupeve tjera të interesit kanë bashkëkoordinuar aktivitetet përgatitore për antarësimin e Kosovës në Open Government Partnership. Mendon edhe korrekt qeveria e Kosovës përmes Ministrisë së Integrimit Evropiane edhe formalisht zotohet për të qenë antare e OGP-së, duke dërguar letër të shprehjes së interesit në adresën e Komitetit Mbikëqyrës të OGP-së, përmes së cilës Republika e Kosovës merr zotimin e saj për të qenë antare e kësaj iniciative globale. Grupi koordinues ka zhvilluar gjithsej 6 aktivitete dhe takime koordinuese sa i përket agjendës dhe përgjegjësive që kanë dalë në këtë proces. Gjithashtu, antarët e grupit koordinues kanë përgatitur fushat të konsultimeve online me palët e interesit, qytetarët dhe me përfaqësues të institucioneve të ndryshme, përfshirë regionet më të mëdha në territorin e Kosovës, ku janë zhvilluar aktivitete dhe debate me qytetarët dhe shoqërinë civile. Gjatë tyre debateve janë identifikuar dhe adresuar probleme dhe kërkesa të vetë qytetarëve që janë inkorporuar në planin nacional veprimit. Andaj qeveria e Kosovës në mbledhjen e saj datës 29 të vitit 2000 prill të 2014 në mënyrë unanime ka miratuar planin nacional të veprimit 2014-2016 I cili së bashku me deklaratën e OGP-s I është dorëzuar komitetit mbikëqyrës të OGP-s. Plani nacional I veprimit të Republikës Kosovës përmban gjithsej 29 veprime dhe 42 nën veprime. Aktualisht institucionet e Kosovës kanë arritur që të realizojnë 7 veprime dhe 4 nën veprime. Ndërsa veprimet tjera janë në proces të implementimit. Për dallim nga 66 shtete anëtare të OGP-s, Kosova edhe pse ka përmbushur kriteret minimale të pranimit në OGP, edhe pse ka realizuar një proces jashtëzakonisht intenziv, transparent dhe gjithëpërfshirës, edhe pse ka zbatuar në përpikri planin dhe standardet të OGP-s, Kosova është përballur me një sfidë me të cilën nuk është përballur asnjë shtet që ka tentuar të bëhet anëtar OGP-s. Kjo sfidë ka të bëjë me bllokimin dhe pastaj refuzimin nga ana e udhëheqjes së Komitetit Mbikëqyrës të OGP-s në Meksikë. Pas 2 vitesh që kur Kosova ka dërguar letrën e shprehjes së interesit, e ka marrë përgjigjen Qeveria e Kosovës në të cilën thuhet se momentalisht procesi antarësimit Kosovës në OGP nuk mund të lëvizë përpara për shkaqet e statusit të saj politik. Siç jeni të informuar, OGP ka arritur të hartoj dhe të zbatoj rregullore me qeverisë dhe funksionet e OGP-së. Dhe kjo rregullore, lejon të citoj fjalët që fillon me këtë hyrje. Filloj citatin. Open Government Partnership është një iniciativë e re shumë palëshe, ku përfshihen qeveri, shoqëria civile, sektori biznesit, që synojnë të sigurojnë zotime të veprimeve konkrete dhe qeverit për të promovuar transparenca, fuqizimin e qytetarisë aktive, luftën kundër korrupsionit dhe shfrytëzimin e teknologjisë së re për të fuqizuar qeverisjen e mirë, përfundimit citat. Pra në aspektin parimor dhe ligjor, Kosovës në këtë kontekst I është bërë një e padrejtë, me vetë faktin se I mohohet e drejta që ajo të jetë antare e plotë e kësaj iniciative. Në bazë kësaj rregullore, në asnjë pikë të saj nuk parashihet që një vendi mund t'i mohohet e drejta për antarësim vetëm për shkak të raporteve individuale që shtetet që janë antare të Komitetit Mbikëqyrës të OGP-s dhe Kosovës në këtë rast. Në lidhje me këtë, lejoni pjesën e fundit të fjalimit që duke cituar kryeministrin e Mbretërisë së Bashkuar, zotin David Cameron, I cili më 31 tetor 2013, me rastin e hapjes samitit vjetor të OGP-s në Londër, në përfundim të fjalimit të tij thotë, citoj: "Ato që unë kam përshkruar sot nuk është e lehtë për ne politikanë. Transparenca sjell rreziqe dhe kjo është diçka që ne përballemi në baza ditore me të. Mirë po, kjo është e domosdoshme për qeverinë. Mirë po, koha dhe historia në ka mësuar se qeverisja e hapur ndërtën vende dhe shoqëritë të sukseshme. Nga fëmijët në për Afrikë, të cilët varen nga kjo, nga pensionistët e këti vendi që mbështeten në të, kjo ka rëndësi. Prandaj, le të arrijm këtë momentum, le të ecim për para dhe kur të vi koha, historia të shkruaj për ne, le të sigurohemi se ky brez u gjet, nuk u gjet indiferent për fundimin e citatit. Me fjalë tjera, kjo është edhe kërkesa e qytetarëve të Kosovës, që ajo të mos bllokohet për shkaqet politikave ditore. Mirë po, të jepet mundësia që të zhvillohen, që të zhvilloj demokracinë e saj dhe krahas shteteve demokratike të jetë pjesë e nismave të përbashkëta globale. Ju falenderoj.
Out. That's it. My microphone starts working so I can speak normal again. Thank you, Mr. Gashi. Thank you very much for your your speech, and it certainly opened to us another aspect of the OGP process. But yet we have to follow on with the two remaining speakers on the panel. Three remaining speakers. We have the representative of Croatia, Mr. Igor Vidacek, who will tell us briefly what and why brings Croatia to OGP, and as a representative of the region, as well as country itself.
Well, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm here, well, not only on behalf of the Croatian government, but also on behalf of Open Governance Partnership Steering Committee, as Croatia is serving as a steering committee member currently. And I'm very glad that I'm able to join one new opportunity for regional cooperation. That was an issue that Croatia was strongly advocating, also within the steering committee membership, but also by allowing various forums for discussion among countries in the region. I may remind you that we organized one of the first European meetings in Dubrovnik in 2012, where we initiated some of these discussions, and I'm very glad that the opportunities for discussion are continuing. Croatia joined Open Government Partnership at a very last stage of its European Union accession process. And for us, it was really considered as a complementary effort to what we have been already doing within the European Union accession process related reforms. And it was one of the ways to ensure sustainability reforms that we have undertaken during the whole EU accession process. And also, especially now in the post-EU accession period, where there are no so many similar safety mechanisms as we had during the EU accession process when it comes to issues we are discussing today. And what I would really like to mention here is also one of the lessons learned from Croatia, but also is related to the context in which we are discussing today, and that is the fact that probably there is no region in the world today that is where the countries are undergoing such a structured and comprehensive process of reforms that are related to the European Union accession process, that are dealing with all areas of social, political, economic life. And this is why I think it's extremely important to consider OGP as a tool, as a platform for strengthening these efforts, and not as additional structure for dialogue or an additional platform for discussing some of these issues. These should be considered as a complementary, and I would even say cross-fertilizing processes, processes that are mutually enriching and benefiting from each other. And also, probably there is no region in the world where there is such a focus, strong focus on creating more enabling environment for civil society development. I cannot really think of any group of countries that are undergoing such a structured approach to changing the environment in which civil society operates through the European Union new political conditionality efforts that are measuring the progress in civil society government cooperation through a huge technical assistance project that is supporting capacity building for civil society, through a self-organized assessment process by civil society organizations from the region gathered around the Balkan Civil Society Development Network that are monitoring the performance of the government in the area of civil society. And I'm saying this because it's extremely important to raise the awareness about all the efforts that are already existing in the region, because this region, I'm strongly convinced, can really lead by example. Can lead by example when it comes to reforms in the area of civil society government cooperation, in the area of open partnership, open government related to the reforms. There are tremendous opportunities that are now opening, especially when it comes to creating synergies between issues that were usually not really considered to be complementary issues, that were usually advocated separately, such as open data, access to information, civil society enabling environment agenda. These issues were usually advocated by policy experts and policy communities that were not always working together. And now when we have a group of governments, civil society experts, business communities, academia, that are all discussing these cross-connected policy issues, I think that the potential for reforms is huge, and I really hope that we will be able to use it. And having said that, I'm really looking forward to the continuation of discussion that we will have over the next 2 days, and I also look forward to receiving some of the questions from the audience.
Lost my microphone again. We have still one representative from the government, another member state of the European Union already, Zerado Poichu, representing Romanian government, also state secretary, so a very practical view on how government works day to day basis, is ready to share Romanian position on OGP and what brings Romania and still keeps Romania in OGP.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this regional meeting. I'm from Romania, so I'm not a Western Balkan country, although I would like to be in the Western Balkans. There are several things that I would like to address. First of all, it's a big thank you for your support in Romania becoming a member of the steering committee in OGP this year in the elections held this July. So continuing or taking from Croatia, you have another ally in the region in OGP, so please use us, both of us. And since you got this invitation for food for thought, more than to open this real discussion and a real debate around the subject of the OGP, there are two things I would like to raise. First of all, being a regional event, you probably know that OGP announced that during the UN General Assembly, the member states, the OGP member states, were asked to sign a declaration supporting the UN agenda for sustainable development to 2030. It is important because OGP got a momentum and got somehow an involvement at an international level. 65 countries is not very little, so they're important subject that member states tend to address. On the other hand, you have national action plans done or in a process to be done. Somehow it's a missing part between those international efforts and the national efforts, and the answer is the region. And food for thought, how about a regional action plan? How about things that will move, and you have common subject, we have common subject, we all have common subject around this area. How about putting them into a regional action plan? Beyond national action plan. Would that help civil society engagement all around the region? Would that help more political commitment towards OGP? There are questions to debate. Another thing I would like to address, and it's another food for thought if you want. The governments tend to be very close. It was a habit of the government, and OGP brought this idea of opening and dialogue with the civil society, and we saw a lot of good examples and best practices around this area in internationally. But there's another there's a thing we noticed that is missing. How about promoting bad practices? How about government saying we failed in doing this? How about the government coming open to citizens and says we didn't manage to do this? how isn't this the spirit of openness we all ask for? Isn't it this the main benefit in opening the door towards the beneficiaries of your decisions, towards making a better thing? So there are two things that I would like to address, and of course we can share our good and bad experiences in Romania, but it's more important to have the debate than to only say, well, we have done this and you'll probably take it to apply to your national context and see if it's working, come back with some results or not. So it's more important to have this dialogue around good things, but also on the things that didn't work. The openness is not stopping on the government. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Turciu. I think it's an excellent idea to think about in upcoming days. How about sharing bad practices? I must say, I suggested it once myself. It failed. But this is a different region, different participants. But with this, again, I turn to Paul Masson. Paul is the representative of OGP itself here. He's the representative of the civil society engagement, for civil society engagement with OGP, and the support unit. Paul, if you could take it up from where we just left it, what are the things that are key to peer learning between governments, also of course including the civil society organizations, in themselves? What are the key issues that governments, in your experience, have shared, are ready to share, are willing to share? And last but not least, how about sharing the good and bad practices? And what would be the things you see are the key issues to share, to cross-territorialization of ideas, as your dear neighbor just said, in the region of West Balkans, and of course not excluding Romania and other neighbors?
Thank you. I mean, it's a big question. It's I think there's a lot of sharing happening in OGP, but not enough yet. I think we're sharing practices, best practices, good practices, practices on how to work with civil society, which is challenging for some governments. But I think one thing we would have to get better at is in a way building on what Radu was saying, is perhaps it's not a reasonable plan, but it is sets of countries taking the leadership and the ownership of specific topics and moving ahead with that inspiring other countries. And one of the questions you asked in your email is, do you speak open government? And that triggered a lot of thinking in my head. Perhaps it was the jet lag. The first thing I thought was, well, of course I do. I work for the Open Government Partnership, so if I don't, I have a fundamental problem. But then it made me think about languages and how do you learn languages. Yes, of course, it's important to learn about semantics and structures and rules of languages. But if you really want to speak a language, you have to also understand the much more intangible aspects of it. You have to have a feel for the language. You have to know which words can exactly say what you want to say. If you want to be able to, on the one hand, write a formal letter to a bureaucracy if something is not going how you want it, and the next day you might want to win a woman's heart, which asks for a completely different language. And I think that's what OGP is also about. It is, on the one hand, about the structure of government, about laws and policies and how do we do things, but it is also very much about the culture of government, about changing the culture of government. And that's where it becomes very challenging to do. That's a lot more difficult to do than passing laws or ticking boxes. Involving citizens and really listening to citizens, I think, is what is difficult for governments and where peer learning would really help. And I think that would be my sort of piece for thought for the coming days. I think we need more people that speak the language of open government so skillfully and so passionately that they can convince others to speak the same language. One example, last time I was in Tirana, Minister HARITO addressed us, a group with mostly civil society, as you said, and she spoke about her priorities for OGP in this country. And of course she spoke about the importance of including commitments around access to information and open data, but she also spoke from the heart that changing bureaucracies from the inside by changing the way bureaucracies recruit their civil servants was one of the things she cared about. Looking out for skills more than facing clientism that is part of bureaucracies. And that was when she won my heart, because you could see she was passionate about it. I think as a region, the Balkans share a past and share a future. And the EU accession program, challenging as it is, I think is an important part to include in OGP action plans, but not enough. If you talk about peer learning, peer sharing, working together, I hope that extends beyond what the EU asks for. It extends beyond passing laws and policies and ticking off boxes, but it really stretches the ambition of the region to include commitments that change the way government was done in this region for decades, that brings in the citizens, that really makes the government include the expertise and the views and the policy ideas of citizens, resulting in societies where citizens once again trust their politicians and their leaders. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. I think it's a wonderful experience of sharing and a set of good ideas to ponder in the upcoming days, if I may just briefly summarize. And I leave a room for one more question, which is slightly different than probably normally you would hear in these events. We spoke about trusted inclusion, as the goals, as the minister at the beginning said, and I would like to stress another thing that the minister mentioned, that this is not about technology, this is about changing mindsets, and Paul also underlined it, referring to what the minister had said before. So there are many nodding heads, and I believe it's true. So the question is, how can OGP get better at winning over the hearts and minds of people outside the political circles, outside the governmental circles, but really also including the citizens themselves, changing citizens' minds and hearts in the way they relate to their government. Several of the speakers mentioned that OGP is a tool of the government. Tools of government, of course, are very well-known set of words in the policy science as such, and it's very nice that it has become a legitimate tool of government in the region. Regardless of your aims, it is a tool, and I'm glad to hear, I think we all are glad to hear that it's used it that way. Several of you also underlined that OGP is a tool that helps to sustain reforms. Again, regardless of why they were started, whether this is EU accession or post-EU processes, that it helps sustainability and it helps to pull it together and keep it together towards a common goal in the country but also in the region. And finally, at least some of you called for some challenging ideas. How about sharing mistakes? I'd like to underline that, why not? It has been voiced repeatedly. I believe my own was in the European Parliament. That wasn't, again, a very successful one, but let's ponder it again today. It's some of the examples of maybe mistakes, maybe not mistakes, were shared here this morning. We heard them as critique, and we must learn from each other's mistakes. Where else is the better way to do that? So before going on to winning hearts and minds through the OGP, I had another idea as I flew here, and I thought, where have I met a community that are most passionate about the same principles that OGP stands for? And I must say that this is the community of foreign direct investors in all countries. I've never met a community more passionate about transparency, openness, good governance, good justice systems, quality of decisions. They are ready to defend it once they're in the country. They want to trust the system. So how do you see, all of you, those who are ready and willing to answer, this is not a mandatory question for all, how do you see that OGP could help the foreign direct investment in your country, so drive economic development, apart from involving civil society, making governance more quality, making decisions better, but driving economics. How do you see it is possible? So, we can start with the Minister Harito if you're ready. We have your labor already ready, so those of you who are ready.
Okay, as many things were said, and we are very participating here, I propose to make it more dynamic and to follow a strict protocol, but just a very short thought. I think, first of all, that we, or all of us, except, of course, those that are already in European Union, we are knocking at the heaven's door. We are trying to go to Europe. But with experience, all of us, we know that the road to heaven is finally more important than heaven, because it is during the road that we will transform ourselves. Once we are in, okay, the most of the work is done. So, in this regard, I think OGP is a tool, a supplementary tool, to help us during this road to heaven to go faster, to go better, and of course, in this regard, it is the same thing. The FDI will be there more for all our countries once we have better government, better services, more transparency in choosing the economic operators, and all the principles of OGP are at the same time the principles of the framework for the accession to Europe.
Thank you.
Open government is the political and economic and social topic. Open government is very important like tools for small countries. We recognize in Montenegro that chance and challenges. Open government is democratic and democracy and also transparency dimension. What is democracy today? It is a philosophical topic, yes. It is a goal of modern society, but one of the dimensions of modern democracy is possibility to change and test government every 4 years by election. But 4 years is a long period in modern life. Open government has chance for citizens to test government decision every day, to test not only political decision, test to decision from economic area, and for government also very important to recognize what is the request of citizens daily, not after 4 years. It's very important for modern democratic society. And also in other sides, very important for transparency, for control, and for monitoring of public funds, and for control government in that area. It's not so easy for development, but open government is the best tool for faster change society in developing countries.
Thank you, Mr. Lazovic. So, Zagic, you're writing something as well. So.
Yes. I wanted to mention in the introduction that I think that it's a very strong tool for economic development and for making a good framework for investment and for changing administration, state administration. And I mean that we could different kind of dialogue, and I want to. I forget to mention that we include civil society in providing our action plan for public administrative reform, which is very important, and for this thing. What does it mean? To provide good laws, good and transparent procedures, changing administrative habit, mm-hmm. and in all that areas, of course, provide transparency of that procedures and law, and Commission. I think that is the all together makes a better environment for investment in our country and in all region.
Thank you. Is there anybody else willing to join this question?
Of course, normally that the element of investment and development in our societies, it is very much linked with the way how we function within our societies. If we have open and more transparent system, then definitely we can be more lucky to get more investments, which is very important for our development. But again, looking from the point of view of local government, I think that in this aspect there is a double role that you play. First of all, pledging and working for much more decentralized system, which is very important for development and realization of your project in the atmosphere of, from my point of view, in still very highly centralized societies. So that the centralization, it is something which has to do with the understanding of a democracy, of absolutely making all the things in one place, like a decision. And the decentralization of the decisions, normally it is very important. So that absolutely the other moment is the investments as well in the capacities of the local self democracies. Why? Because if you do a comparison between the level of formation of the administration in the central level and in the local level, there is a serious discrepancy. And in the same time, you need to have administration in the municipality who has to work in the documentation for different kind of IPA cross-border projects and different activities which requires higher level normally of capacities. That's the reason why this is one very complex process and definitely a process which is linked with each other.
Thank you. Mr. HARITO had another say, and we still have another willing to share from Ego with the chat from Mr. HARITO.
Just to add something and to inform all the participants, we have held a very strong territorial reform during last year, and we have now from approximately 400 communes and municipalities, we have now only 61. And this was done exactly with the aim to reinforce them, to decentralize more, and to give them all the means and financial, human, to be stronger and to collaborate more in all the aspects with the others. So this was the aim of the reform that was done with the strong support of our international partners, and we hope from this year that we'll begin to the concrete results of all that.
Mr. Vidicek, last but not least.
Yes, well, when I think about personally what is really needed to change the environment in which foreign direct investors would be interested to really invest and to change in general the environment in which we speak open government, I often think about an old proverb that says, first be, then do, and only then talk. Usually we have the other way around. We talk a lot about it, sometimes we do, and rarely we are really convinced and generally live the open government from the heart. This is where I think it's really important also that we always remember that we first really need to believe in it. We really need to be convinced of the value of the reforms. And we need to practice it, because practicing dialogue, practicing cooperation is the only way to build our own capacities, to build the capacity of civil society and wider group of stakeholders, and then talk. And only then, I think, also foreign direct investors, but also wider community and citizens will be convinced that we are really genuine and credible in what we are doing.
Thank you very much. With that, we have come to the closing point of our opening panel discussion, I'd say. I think the wonderful suggestion is that practice makes perfect, and we will have 2 days of practice of OGP that will make us perfect at the end of the day. We covered at least 3 topics here. We looked at the question of what has changed in OGP and what brings countries in OGP. We looked at what countries can do in the Western Balkans and in the MEA region together, and had some ideas on that, some challenging, some different, some new. And finally, we also brought in the economic aspect, which is often missed from these discussions when we talk about openness. We mostly talk about the civil society, the good of, for the citizens at the end of the day. As the, you mentioned that everybody who comes to talk, they actually want work. And no access to information law will bring you work. It will be the economics. So maybe OGP can also help to bring work. Thank you very much. I think it's a wonderful panel. Let's give a round of applause to our panelists and have a wonderful session. And there is probably somebody who knows better than myself what happens next. And it is Sadie's.
Thank you very much for coming back to this last but very important and very interesting session. I found the suggestion of Mr. Radu Puciu for presenting our best, our worst cases is very interesting, and we have noted it down. Maybe we'll do it in our next regional meeting. However, for this one, we have decided to have our best initiatives from our governments on improving transparency, public citizen engagement, and use of technology. We have here 5 distinguished panelists, representatives of governments, who will present their best spots. And let me first introduce. We have from Albania, Ms. Elisa Proko, Chief of Cabinet, Ministry of Local Governance. We have from Serbia, Zeljko Olšeković, Ministry of Public Administration. We have from Macedonia, Ms. Gordana Dimitrovska, Ministry of Information Society and Administration. We have from Montenegro, Mr. Stevan Ljubović, Deputy Minister for e-Governance. And we have from Croatia, Sandra Pernar, Office for Cooperation with Civil Society, Government of Croatia. All of them will present some initiatives that their governments have undertaken. And then we have decided to have a winner of this mini competition, if I may call it this way. In all of your participant folders, you have some voting sheets, and I would kindly ask you that after the presentations, you fill in which one you found as the most interesting and the most OGP related presentation and initiative. And then, because we'll all go to Hotel Tirana to continue for the second half of the day, I would kindly ask you to belt your voting in the box, which is at the entry floor, and then our volunteers will take care that everything will be transparent, and tomorrow we will launch who will be the winner of the bright spot. If I may start with the first presentation, Ms. Elisa Proko.
Kënaqësi të jesh pjesë e një konference kaqtëmadhe rajonale, e cila diskuton çështje shumë të rëndësishme mbi qeverisjen e hapur, angazhimin e qytetarëve, kontributin e tyre, por edhe përgjithshmërinë e institucioneve publike dhe përgjigjet apo mbështetjen që këto institucione i japin qytetarëve ndaj nevojave të tyre. Gjithashtu ndihemi privilegjuar që kam mundësinë edhe shansin që të prezantoj një prej iniciativave më inovative edhe më të reja të qeverisë shqiptare, por jo vetëm. Kjo iniciativë faktikisht nuk vjen vetëm në kuadër të luftës ndaj korrupsionit dhe parandalimit të korrupsionit në vend, por edhe vjen si një prej angazhimeve specifike që qeveria shqiptare, por jo vetëm, edhe ministri i shtetit për çështjet vendore, i cili në të njëjtën kohë është edhe koordinator kombëtar kundër korrupsionit, kanë në kuadër të partnershipit të qeverisjes së hapur. Pra më përkohë, unë dua të filloj me prezantimin. Praktikisht, ne kemi menduar për të prezentuar këtë lloj iniciative të re të qeverisë, pasi kemi konstatuar që perceptimi i publikut ndaj korrupsionit është i lartë, dhe jo vetëm në sektor specifik, por kudo, është shumë i përhapur. Kështu që normalisht mbasi vlerësimi paraprak që ne bëm dhe duke marrë në konsiderat absolutisht edhe kërkesat e qytetarëve, por jo vetëm, edhe të institucioneve publike në kuadër të digitalizimit të shërbimeve, modernizimit të tyre, ofrimit të saktë, të shpejtë në kohë ndaj qytetarëve, si dhe penetrimin e internetit, jetojmë në epokën e digitalizimit apo moshën e internetit. Të gjithë kanë akses në internet pavarësisht moshës së tyre. Kështu që për të lehtësuar këtë komunikim qeveri-qytetar, ne menduam për të krijuar këtë iniciativë dhe këtë nismë të qeverisë, që është portali unik për denoncimin e rasteve të korrupsionit, stopkorrupsionit.al. Nga një vlerësim paraprak që ne bëm faktikisht, ne rezultoi që denoncimi i rasteve të korrupsionit ishte një iniciativë fragmentarizuar. Dhe më thonë, kemi pasur një kakofoni portalesh për denoncimin e korrupsionit, dhe kjo ishte e pamundur, pasi kjo i qorientonte qytetarët, dhe ata nuk dinin më pastaj se ku të denonconin, çfarë të denonconin, çfarë procedurash burokratike duhet ndiqnin për të denoncuar një rast korruptiv, dhe se si do duhet ta bënin atë. Kështu që ishte momenti i dur për të unifikuar këtë lloj procedure dhe këtë lloj praktike dhe për të sjellë midis nesh një portal unik ku qytetarët tashmë janë shumë të qartë se ku duhet të shkojnë, çfarë duhet të klikojnë, çfarë duhet të denoncojnë dhe se çdo gjë ndodh shumë shpejt, shumë thjesht. Portali është një mjet jashtëzakonisht miqësor, është user friendly, domethënë nuk ka absolutisht probleme dhe nuk të kërkon shumë kohë për të punuar me të. Kështu që ky ishte momenti kur ne vendosëm ta dizajnonim edhe ta konceptonim si iniciativë dhe më pas ta lançonim atë në dyshkur të këtij viti. Portali është i strukturuar në një formë të tillë duke paraqitur në kutiza të veçanta sektorët më problematik, pra sektorët të cilët kanë një perceptim shumë të lartë të korrupsionit. Dhe jo më kot janë zgjedhur, domethënë nuk është bërë një renditje e rastësishme, këtu është bërë një renditje në bazuar mbi këtë lloj perceptimi. Secila prej kutizave, ashtu siç e përmenda, paraqet një sektor të veçantë dhe mjafton që ti të klikosh mbi një nga këto kutiza dhe ty të hapet një formular jashtëzakonisht shumë i thjeshtë për të përdorur dhe për të plotësuar. Avantazhet e rësia që sjell ky portal është që nga mbrapa këtij portali qëndron një strukturë e tërë e cila monitoron dhe mbështet funksionimin e duhur të tij. Por para se të arrijmë te kjo pjesë, dëshiroj të theksoj faktin që ky portal të jep mundësi për të qëndruar anonim ose jo. Të gjithë qytetarët që kërkojnë edhe kanë nevojë për denoncuar një aferë korruptive, por jo vetëm, mund të kenë edhe ankesa të ndryshme mbi cilësinë e shërbimeve, pasi kjo ka rezultuar faktikisht edhe nga statistikat që ne kemi nxjerr, që jo çdo rast i raportuar është korrupsion. Ne i japim mundësi për të qëndruar anonim, por kjo nuk do të thotë që ne nuk merremi seriozisht me këto raste. Secili zyrtar përgjegjës apo ministri përgjegjës që e merr në dorëzim këtë denoncim fillon hetimin e menjëhershëm, mbasi bëhet një lloj verifikimi më i kujdesshëm se sa në rastet kur denoncimi nuk është anonim. Pra, ashtu siç e përmenda, ky formular i thjesht të jep mundësinë për në rastet kur nuk qytetari vendos të mos qëndrojë anonim, të plotësosh të dhënat, nuk kërkon shumë kohë. Ju vëm dispozicion qytetarëve që të përzgjedhin me lehtësi institucionin ndaj të cilit ata ankohen apo ku ata kanë janë përballur me afera korruptive dhe Por më tepër, në mënyrë që të uvim në ndim të gjithë, jo vetëm qytetarëve, por edhe zyrtarëve përgjegjës të cilët do të merren nga ana tjetër me trajtimin edhe me ndjekjen e këtyre rasteve të korrupsionit, qytetarët kanë mundësi për të aplikuar fajle të ndryshme në formate të ndryshme në, dhe duke siguruar informacione të ndryshme. Pra, mund të aplodojnë video, mund të aplodojnë foto, mund të aplodojnë file Excel, Word apo çfarë do lloj formati tjetër. Të gjitha këto më pas merren nga zyrtarët përgjegjës si informacione shtesë apo informacione plotësuese mbi informacion mbi denoncimin e përshkruar. Dhe menjëherë kur klikohet dërgo, informacioni shkon në katër drejtime të ndryshme, por në të njëjtën kohë. Pra, kemi një informacion të shpërndarë në katër burime, së pari shkon në zyrën e kryeministrisë, në ministrin për kace, ku qëndron një zyrtar përgjegjës, i cili fillon në mëndshme marrjen e denoncimit, fillon me njëherë ndjekjen edhe trajtimin e rastit, edhe me institucionet e tij të varësisë. Në departamentin antikorrupsion pranë zyrës së kryeministrit, kjo ndodh kjo struktur ndihmon të gjithë zyrtarët përgjegjës, por edhe zyrën e ministrit të shtetit për çështjet vendore në ato raste kur paraqitet një kompleksitet i veçantë dhe ka nevojë për hetime të mëtejshme në mënyrë që më pas ky denoncim të shkojë pranë instancave të tjera dhe organeve ligjëratuese. Dhe së fundi ne kemi një burim të katërt, por jo të fundit, por jo më pak të rëndësishëm, për të mos thënë që është më i rëndësishmi, është zyra operative e portalit, e cila qëndron po përsëri në kryeministri dhe punon mbushtësisht me zyrën e ministrit të shtetit për çështjet vendore. Është kjo zyrë e cila monitoron të gjithë procesin, që prej fillesave të saj dhe deri në përfundim. Pra, kjo zyrë monitoron dhe shef në çdo moment nëpërmjet një sistemi të hapur praktikisht se cila instancë e ka në dorë denoncimin për momentin, cili është zyrtari përgjegjës i cili po trajton këtë denoncim. A janë respektuar apo jo afatet ligjore brenda cilit ky rast duhet të trajtohet dhe duhet i kthehet përgjegjës qytetarit. Dhe gjitha këto të janë të shfaqura dhe shfaqen në një dashboard i cili funksionon dhe përdoret nga sala operative, por jo vetëm, edhe nga zyrtarët përgjegjës gjithashtu. Pra, ne kemi një panoramë të përgjithshme se çfarë ndodh me rastin. Secili rast denoncimi në momentin që regjistrohet në portal merr një numër unik identifikimi. Pra, ne e dimë shumë mirë se cili rast i përket kujt. Kjo është e ndarë bazuar në adokutizat apo në sektorët përgjegjës dhe na ndihmon më pas për të bërë një follow-up edhe një ndjekje të rastit deri në përfundim. Pra, ashtu siç po e shihni, këto janë disa nga të dhënat që ky portal ofron. Pra, kemi një procedurë shumë mirë të përcaktuar. Tashmë kemi dhe bazën ligjore, kemi një urdhër të kryeministrit i cili parashikon çfarë do lloj procedure që nga fillimi dhe të themi dërgimi i denoncimit në portal dhe deri në përfundim të procesit të brendshëm. Pra, si ndiqet të gjitha hapat që secili aktor në këtë proces duhet të ndjek për mbarvajtjen edhe për sigurimin e një trajtimi të duhur të rastit. Pra, deri në përfundim ose të dërgimit të rastit pranë organeve ligjëratuese apo kthimit të përgjigjes qytetarit brenda 30 ditëve. Po cilat janë rezultatet që ka ofruar ky portal faktikisht? Ajo që ne jemi munduar edhe po vazhdojmë të punojmë mbi të janë prodhimi i statistikave. Neve duhem të shohim një lloj trendi se si do të shkojnë si janë trajtuar rastet, bazuar jo vetëm mbi statuset e caktuara të tyre, por edhe të llojit që ato paraqiten. Pra, sa raste janë ankesa, sa prej këtyre raportimeve konsiderohen si korrupsioni mirëfillt, apo sa raste janë duplikime, apo cilat raste janë të zgjidhura tashmë. Kështu që për të gjitha këto ne kemi statistika, unë këtu kam paraqitur vetëm disa prej tyre, ne po mundohemi që këto statistika të përmirësojmë dhe të kapim edhe aspektet të tjera shumë të rëndësishme të cilat do të na ofrojnë të dhëna për të marrë veprime të mëtejshme dhe masa të mëtejshme për përmirësimin e këtij portali. Gjithashtu kemi edhe një lloj ndarje që e bëjmë bazuar mbi institucionet për të parë edhe këtu një lloj trendi apo për të parë se ku çalojmë më shumë praktikisht, cilat janë këto fusha dhe këto sektor ku qytetarët ndjejnë dhe perceptojnë që ka problematika të mëdha. Dhe ngelet shumë për të përmirësuar. Megjithatë, nga të gjitha këto statistika deri më sot, ashtu siç e pat kemi rreth 8550 denoncime në total për 7 muaj funksionim të portalit, nga të cilat dhe nga hetimet administrative në përfundim të cilave kemi rezultuar që kemi 52 referime në prokurori dhe kemi pasur një qindra masa disiplinore ndaj zyrtarëve publik. Ka dhe masa të tjera absolutisht, por është e pamundur që t'i listojmë të gjitha sot. Gjithashtu jemi munduar dhe nuk duam të harojmë edhe të lëmë njëan një lloj statistike shumë të rëndësishme, atë ofruar nga Google Analytics faktikisht për të parë se sa vizitorë e vizitojnë faqen tonë dhe trendi kryesor dhe ajo që është më interesante nga këto shifra është që kemi 71.8% vizitorë të rinj. Dhe absolutisht duke qenë një portal apo një iniciativë e cila është shumë mobile friendly, kemi rreth 1552 klikime nga telefoni, plus edhe klikimet nga desktop apo ndarjet e tjera. Pra është gjatë punës tonë ne mbajmë parasysh edhe këto lloj statistikash, të cilat na ndihmojnë absolutisht të përmirësohemi. Absolutisht kemi pasur histori suksesi. Është pamundur t'i listojmë të gjitha prej tyre, unë kam marrë vetëm disa shembuj faktikisht, shumë konkret. Ky është një rast kur qytetari denoncon një aferë korruptive të ndodhur në zyrat e vendore të regjistrimit të pasurive të palueshme në Korç. Nuk i është ofruar shërbimi i kërkuar, jo vetëm kaq, po edhe pse ka pasur dokumentacion të sakt, original, të plot, përsëri i është kërkuar rishfet për të kryer shërbimin e duhur. Dhe mbas një investigimi dhe hetimi administrativ të kryer nga zyrtarët përgjegjës në bashkëpunim me institucionet e tyre të varësisë, u masat e marra mbas këtyre verifikimeve ishin që i vetëm qytetari e mori shërbimin e kërkuar për të munguar, por gjithashtu u krye edhe kallëzim për fillimin e procedimit penal për dy punonjës të zyrës, të cilët kishin kërkuar rishfet. Gjithashtu një histori tjetër suksesi vjen nga fusha e tatimeve. Praktikisht qytetari denoncon dy prej inspektorëve të tatimeve të zonës, në zonën e Progradecit, ku qytetari që denoncon është një qytetari biznesi i cili është i regjistruar dhe shmyen të gjitha detyrimet tatimore sipas ligjit, ndërkohë që rreth tij ka pasur biznese të cilat jo vetëm që nuk kanë qenë të regjistruara, por nuk kanë pasur kuponet tatimore dhe ka pasur shumë problematika të tjera. Dhe nga verifikimet e kryera ka rezultuar që masat e marra të para kanë qenë faktikisht në inspektorëve të zonës, pasi kanë qenë ata të cilët nuk kanë kryer detyrën e tyre, ato që duhet ta bëjnë në çdo ditë dhe me shumë kujdes. Por gjithashtu, nga kontrolli i kryer në të gjithë zonën, ka rezultuar që 19 prej këtyre subjekteve kanë arritur të regjistrohen në QKR, janë konfiskuar 3 subjekte për mos regjistrim në organin tatimor, janë penalizuar 5 subjekte të cilët nuk kanë pasur kasë fiskale, dhe penalizuar 3 subjekte për jo vetëm për mos përdorim të kasës fiskale, por edhe për printim të biletave të pamiratuara nga printerat fiskale. Kështu që këto janë disa nga historitë e suksesit të cilat ne na inkurajojnë për të vazhduar më tej në punën tonë të pareshtur faktikisht. Unë dua së fundi, duke pasur parasysh edhe limitin e kohë, të listoj disa nga avantazhet që ky portal më ka sjellë. Ka qenë një iniciativë e thash inovative për jo vetëm për qeverinë, po për të gjithë qytetarët. Ka ofruar një transparencë pasi gjithë procesi është i hapur dhe lehtësisht i aksesueshëm, ofron shpejtësi pasi çdo veprim ndërmerret në kohë dhe brenda një afati ligjor të caktuar. Gjithashtu ka një komunikim të pa ndërprerje me qytetarin. Pra gjithmonë kërkohet informacion shtesë apo sqarohet për vijueshmërinë e rastit. Ka një monitorim i cili kryhet jo vetëm nga institucionet përgjegjëse, por edhe nga qyzyrë operative e qëndërzuar dhe ofron gjurmim. Domethënë ne dimë në çfarë lloj momenti kush bën çfarë dhe si bëhet dhe si kryen të gjitha veprimet dhe a kryen apo jo dhe ndiqen gjitha mekanizmat e duhur apo jo.
Shumë faleminderit. Shumë faleminderit Erisa për prezantimin tuaj. We will continue now with Serbia. Minister Ožegović, he will speak on a law on inspection, a law which was recently passed in April, inspection oversight, which was passed on April 2015.
Hello again, and thank you for the opportunity to present our example of good governance. And instead of Serbian e-government portal, where we have almost 500 online services for the citizens, we decided to present this new law on inspection oversight, because I think this is a good example of cooperation with civil society and NGOs, and it helps increasing public integrity, which is one of the main goals of 5 OGP goals. And I strongly believe this law will help to strengthen the systematic function of control in public administration. I came from the local self-government, and I was mayor 8 years in one municipality of 300,000 citizens, and I know how complicated system it was, and we have in previous period, and you can see that in Serbia there have been more than 1,000 laws and bylaws that have covered inspection oversight of different entities and all levels, I can say, and that makes a trouble in implementation of this law. The organization of inspection control was quite fragmented, and there were over 30 inspections within 12 ministries. And the main problem was coordination of that inspection, efficiency, and also necessary pressure on subjects of control by overlapping inspection. In that area, there were many complaints of the companies and businesses. And as we talk about in the first panel, and of course, as well as occasional difficulties in determining which ministry is authorized for certain area, and especially for unregistered subjects. You know, grey economy in this region is very high. In Serbia it's almost 30%, and this is a disaster for the state because the loss of income is almost 5 billion euros yearly. And of course, regulation, procedures and methodology were not transparent, and that was one of the, and not clear, and that was one of the main complaints of businesses also. And together it all affects the competitiveness of our country, I can say of our region, of economy, new investments, and business environment. And that was the reason that we prepared a new draft law on inspection oversight, and it was passed on the National Parliament on April 2015, and the new law has been adopted with the aim of increasing the effectiveness of efficiency and cost effectiveness of inspection oversight, which will regulate this area on the uniform basis and comprehensive manner. And the instrument for that is prescribing clear rules on process of control, standardization of procedures, types and form of inspection, and determining the inspector's authority as well as rights and obligations of subjects of control. and we hope that will consequently lead to a more efficient fight against corruption and growth of public confidence in the government. And all that rules and new laws, bylaws and other documents is on our new website. And establishing, we hope that establishing an efficient system of control of inspectors' performance as well, timely and adequate handling of complaints will also contribute to public confidence in government, as I said in the introduction, having in mind that the inspector are officials that are considered by the public and the representative of the states. Of course, efficient system of control is impossible with new technologies, and new technology that is, I strongly believe, that is the best tool for providing information for citizens, of course, for increasing transparency, fighting against corruptions, and efficiency, increasing efficiency, and for the cost reduction for the citizens, for the business. And new law provides for the establishment of the information system in order to effectively exchange data between the inspections and electronic documents and risk assessment, which is the new instrument in this law in inspection oversight. In our action plan, we actually planned software development, joint IT platform for old inspection in 2016, and by the end of 2017 all inspections should be included in the system of e-inspector. First phase is already completed. We established a new government website of e-inspectors, and on that site we have a lot of laws and bylaws, documents, news, I'm asking for the same time, you know, news, because I think this is important, because this is an example of a good cooperation, and that is the next topics in this presentation. And we established a new coordination commission, and that everything that is on our website, and one of the main goals. Oh, something happened. And one of the main goals is, of course, in this law is increasing transparency, as I said before, and transparency was showed in drafting the law. The entire process was monitored by the civil society organizations and set as a good practice for drafting law. Transparency International, as I mentioned before, was included in all process from the beginning until the end, and we have public hearings throughout the Serbia in six or seven towns, and we collecting contributions and suggestions for civil society. But in implementation, now we have every week we have presentation in regional chambers of commerce with all stakeholders, you know, representative of inspections of businesses and of the citizens. The law provides, of course, you can read that on the monitor, obligation of planning, that is the new instruments in the law, alignment and publication of plans of inspection control, establishment of public joint portal, as I said, for all inspection through which the public will be electronically available to exchange information on laws and regulation. And, of course, it provides the ongoing consultation with stakeholders, controls, and certainly for better regulation of the prevention of irregularities in some area, because we established a seven expert group in the coordination body in all extra groups is included, not in all, but in mostly, I think is included the representative of NGOs, which is very good for monitoring the implementation of this process. Of course, this is new approach, business and inspections in this process and state are partners. The focus is not anymore on punishment, but on preventive measures. The goal is harmonized performance of inspections. We provided the training, which was starting at the end of the year, for the trainers in that inspections. We planned to train over the 200 new trainers. The goal is no overlap of inspections, efficient control of inspection procedures, and as I said, publishing a full inspection plan, which must be adopted of the coordination body, which has representative of all ministries and ministry also. And I will finish with that again. In the sense of European integration, I think this is important law because this law is important for harmonizing all process throughout the European integration, and the legal solutions of this law are harmonized with the acquis, of course, the principles and practices and standards of EU inspections control. Finally, I want to say that I strongly believe that this law will change the thinking of administration because as you can see, has so many problems in the practical coordination and cooperation with inspections, and I think this could help to make a better economic environment, better understanding and functioning of inspections instead and cooperation with businesses in this area. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jelic. We'll proceed now with Macedonia, Ms. Gordana Dimitrovska from Ministry of Information Society and Public Administration, who will be presenting an e-consultation portal called NR.
Thank you, Risa.
I would kindly ask the rest of presenters to keep up the rhythm.
Thank you, Risa. Good afternoon. It's my great pleasure that today I have opportunity to share Macedonian mechanism through which we achieve higher standards in transparency and accountability and responsibility of public institutions. For beginning, I would like to share that one of the key strategic priorities of our government is increasing economical growth, competitiveness in the long run, higher employment rate, and also increasing the living standards of our citizens and quality of the life. In the same time, the government is dedicated towards effective consultation process, consultation process towards those who are directly affected by the regulations and the government measures. As we all know, that the effective consultation contributes to the gathering and identification of important informations which government further use for drafting the good quality regulation. Public consultation can be seen as one of the main regulatory tools through which we increase transparency, efficiency and effectiveness of the regulation, and in the same time it's used together with another regulatory tools such as regulatory impact assessment. In Macedonian case, I suppose as all other countries in the region, we have a legal framework for conducting the public consultation. On this slide, you can see that we have our articles in our law for operation of state administrations, rule of procedures of the government, regulatory impact assessment, and other bylaws. But what is most important that we tried, beside the traditional way of conducting consultations through working groups or involving the stakeholders in the working groups and organizing public hearings, to tackle wider range of stakeholders through websites of the ministries and different portals, such as one specific portal we have e-democracy for specific or strategic documents, and also ENA or Single National Electronic Registry. In the beginning I mentioned that our government is dedicated towards better regulations. So in 2009 she made the decision that that we have to introduce a new legal procedures which is in complete accord in which are in full compliance with regulatory impact assessment principles, and at the same time build a new mechanism for public consultation where we are consulting not only the draft laws but also the analysis made during the drafting the legislation, and that's the ENA. So ENA, or Single National Electronic Registry, is an electronic system through which we can consult, and or in the same time we can share information about not only the legislation or the laws, but in the same time about the draft analysis made by the ministries, and also there is data for a consolidated version of the legislation. In the same time, this is an electronic tool which stakeholders can use to submit their comments, views directly to the responsible ministries. The main goal of ENA is to give relevant information to our citizens, business community, representative of NGOs, chambers of commerce, but at the same time, during the regulatory impact assessment process, the ministries are using this portal to provocate and to collect information, data and opinions from the stakeholders. When we start in 2009, we were pretty much modest. This portal gives only one-way interaction, but in the end of 2014, we made our last update of this portal. That was the result from our second OGP action plan, 2014-2016. So today we can say that ENR is not providing only one-way interaction or interaction between the government and the citizens, but already we have interaction between the ENR and the e-government session. So what ENR provides? Simplicity, clarity, and of course consultation. So there is an automatic registration without any approval. Each user can choose the area of interest depending on specific institution or legal area. Also, users can get a notification for a new published law or new comments, and also they have opportunity to give their comments without any restriction. How ENR looks like? We try to make it really fashionable to be more user friendly. So on this side, the users can collect a lot of useful information. On the first page, they can find the 10 latest published draft law for consultation, and also the data or information about the 5 latest recommended laws. What also ENA provides, besides the modern design, free of charge access, so it's free of charge for our users, direct link for useful information. One of the biggest benefits what we done is the integration between this portal and e-government session, which prevents draft laws to be submitted to the government session without consulting on this portal. Also, there is a good systematization of regulation according to the categorization of official Gazette of Republic of Macedonia. Also, what is very interesting, we have a configured period for automatic publishment of the comments received from the stakeholders. There is an exact time and date of starting and ending of consultation. So now the stakeholders are really they really know the exact time in which period they can submit their comments. And other relevant information which can be used from the civil society, but also from the governmental institution. During the years, how we build the ENA, we get a lot of help from our ministries, but also from the civil society and all users from NGOs and business community. So today we can say that this is a partnership platform which can increase our mutual trust and building common sense of different issues. And the end, I would like to say that achieving good result, good regulation is a big challenge, demanding and never-ending task. But however, governments are required systematic work to achieve better regulations. I think I managed the time. Thank you a lot. If you have any question, I hope you will have.
And don't forget to fill the forms.
Right? Thank you very much, Gordana. We'll continue now with Montenegro, with Mr. Stevan Jumovic, Deputy Minister for e-Governance, and he will speak about this portal for e-Governance. The remote? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, hello. My presentation will briefly review, but just briefly because we have a time limit, the condition of e-government in Montenegro. Why e-government? Because in our opinion, developing e-government is a start point for developing OGP. Firstly, the basis for development e-government and e-services is the legal terms. As you heard when previous season, you heard of our minister that we made a very significant step when issued law on electronic government in July 2014. This is very important, but in addition to this law, there are two very important regulations which issue this year, regulations on the mode, content and management e-GAM portal, and regulation on content and management of data in unique information system for electronic exchange of information between state authority and state administration, as well as the management of this system. By such a legal basis, Montenegro has made significant progress in the field of e-government. According to the United Nations Government Survey for last year, Montenegro moved from 57th place 2012 to 45th place not this year, last year, this mistake, on the world ranking for e-government, and we are leader in region. You can see that that we go up this position for 57 on 45. On this slide, we can see Montenegro's position in relation to the leaders of e-government last year, special world leader Republic of Korea, and leader in Europe, in the region, France and Spain. It should be emphasized that Montenegro is a very high value in the area of e-participation, and according to the latest report of the World Economic Forum in the field of ICT competence, further indicating all leading position in the region in this field. We still leading. E-government portal. This web address for e-government portal on our language and on English, like this on our language and on English. But because we don't have enough time, I'm not going to present the details of this portal. Instead, I just give some information that can really present the purpose and content of our portal. basic divide of services is on two types, electronic and informatic. And we have 92 electronic and 49 informatic, total in 141. On this slide, you can see division of services by users, 78 for citizen and 56 for business. This table show by levels of substation of e-services. You know these levels. Level 1 is the lowest level, and in this group that includes information services. But we emphasize that we have 19 e-services with level 3, which provides two-way communication and fulfillment of interactive electronic forms with feedback. Therefore, we created good conditions that will transform many of these services to a higher level, level 4 at least, in the near future. In the end of this presentation, we show the type of login on our e-services. You see that 64 services login by mail account. You know that this type is not so control data of information of users, but we have 28 e-service login by certificate and 26 login by certificate and need electronic sign document by this certificate. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Please.
And the last but not the least, we have Croatia. Ms. Sandra Brunar, Office for Cooperation with Civil Society Organizations, will also present a portal on e-consultation.
Thank you. Good day to everyone. Like I said, I will talk about our achievements regarding the...
The technicians, they do have it, for sure.
Yeah. There's
just 1 minute.
So definitely, I will talk about our efforts regarding consultations in general, but first of all, I will present the new portal that we have launched this year in April. It's e-consultations portal. So when we started working on setting up standards for consultations in Croatia, our main challenge was actually how to secure the responsiveness of the government, how to secure that the citizens receive feedback once they comment on certain acts, laws or whatever, and so that they feel really included, that they feel that their contribution was acknowledged, and that they of course then feel motivated to participate further in consultations. At first, from 2009, we started working on developing a legislative framework. It started with the Code of Practice on Consultation, which pretty much established the set of standards to be respected once you are organizing consultations. I would say that most significant steps were made with the amendments to the law on access to information and to the rules of procedures of both the government and the parliament, where now it is obligatory for state bodies to provide feedback on the consultations that were implemented. So they need to issue report on the consultations and they need to give feedback on the comments that they received from the citizens. Not only legislative framework, but also additional efforts were made to secure that we have effective consultations. First of all, detailed guidelines were developed for consultation coordinators, which were appointed in all of the ministries and government offices to work on the implementation of consultation. Also for those coordinators, trainings were organized and they were given the opportunity to have the exchange of experience through peer-to-peer support and thus further improve the standards and the practice of consultations. Through the praxis itself. And also the office started
writing and publishing annual reports on the implementation of the consultations, which furthermore was a new tool for monitoring how the consultations are actually going on and where are the possibilities to further improve them. And as the final step so far, we have launched in April this year the e-consultation portal, which I will present a little bit later. But all of this work that was done resulted in some of the decisions made by the Constitutional Court, which were, like I said, a result of our efforts, but also additional support to those same efforts, because the Constitutional Court in several cases pretty much ruled that if consultations are not held for a certain act, that act can be actually considered to be unconstitutional if a passed. Numbers say it the best, so it's best that we look at the numbers to see what success we have achieved in just a few years. You see that the number of public consultations significantly raised, so from 48 to 544 public consultations in last year. We hope that this year we will have even bigger numbers at the end of the year. But not only that the number of public consultations was raised, also the number of contributions that were received was increased. So more and more citizens, civil society organizations, even companies, crafts and other types of organizations and institutions are getting involved in public consultations. Can we come back, please? Because it's going further. Yes, okay. Apart from this, numbers that are also important are these here on this slide, where you can see that not only... Yeah, I'm not doing anything at this moment. So basically, the numbers here show you that not only that the state bodies now respond to the comments received by the citizens through the reports, but also that the high percentage of those comments is actually being accepted. So almost, you can say that almost 50% of all comments that are received are actually accepted. Can we go to the next slide, please? Key lessons learned through this process were pretty much that the quality of feedback on the results of public consultations is very much important in order to increase the trust of citizens in the whole process, which then motivates them to really get engaged more and more in such consultations. Also, we saw how important it is to have a good policy coordination in order to secure the proper implementation of the consultations among all the state bodies and actually standardizing the whole process among them. And of course, very much important was to train those who work on performing the consultations. So that was one of the key investments to actually transform the style of governance, but also to make consultations more effective. So the central e-consultation portal, like I said, it was launched in April this year. It is now a access point for all consultations organized by state bodies. The significant thing is that it is a really simple way of commenting that this portal allows to all citizens. Once they register, they can comment directly on the document that they are interested in. Also, it is much easier for them to participate in consultations because they receive notifications on all the new consultations that are being opened. They get reminders when certain consultations are going to be closed so that they know that they have a little time to participate if they want to. They receive also notifications on reports once they are issued, so they can go read the report and see what happened with their comments.
Also, it is a huge help to all those who work on conducting consultations in the state bodies, because now the application itself generates all of the comments and all of the answers into a report. So it's a big time-consuming work that is now much easier, and it gives more transparency and openness to both sides, because all of the comments are immediately visible, and because it allows also for all the citizens to openly monitor the feedback that the state bodies are giving. This is just a briefing to see how it looks. So there's a list of all the open consultations, and just by clicking the title of the consultation you can access the document and start commenting. This is how the reports look, so you get the answers to your comments. And these are the results in the 4 months of implementation. So you can see that both sides, state bodies and citizens or the interested public, are starting to use the portal. We are very happy that this is happening. So this is our success story, which we believe would not be such a success if it weren't for all those steps I mentioned that were done in the previous 6 years. So this story of success is actually telling us that we have now built a good ground for effective consultations in Croatia, and we believe that this portal will not be success just for a short time, but also for a period for years to come.
Thank you, Sandra. Thank you very much for all the distinguished panelists. And as Gordana said, please don't forget to vote and bail out your voting at the Hotel Tirana at the voting box. The winner will be launched tomorrow during closing.